Tonight on NewsWatch, as more rockets rain down, Israel steps up. The latest on the unrest in the Middle East.
Plus, even though Republicans and Democrats say they'll work together to find a solution, fiscal cliff fears are growing among Americans.
And we'll take you on a top secret mission that's helping to encourage oppressed Christians in North Korea. All of this and more tonight on NewsWatch. And good evening, everyone. I'm Lee Webb.
And I'm Wendy Griffith. The fighting between Israel and Hamas could get worse. Israel is ready to step up its attacks after another round of missiles were launched toward Tel Aviv.
Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu says Hamas has to stop its rocket attacks before there can be a ceasefire. But so far, talk of peace remains just talk.
Julie Stahl has tonight's top story from Israel.
Hamas intensified its missile barrages against southern Israel over the weekend. More than 560 rockets have slammed into Israel so far, with more than another 300 intercepted by the Iron Dome anti-missile batteries. Chaim Gabso's house on Moshav Bertuvia was hit last week while his wife and children sat protected in their safe room.
I don't want to think what could happen if we didn't have a shelter.
The Israeli army pounded Hamas buildings and weapons storage facilities by land and sea over the weekend. They've targeted more than 1,350 terror sites in the last 6 days in what the army is calling pillar of defense.
The IDF has inflicted significant damage to Hamas headquarters in the Gaza Strip, including the office of the Prime Minister Ismail Haniyeh, the Interior Ministry, the police compound, training camps.
In one case, Palestinians say a bomb killed 11 members of one family, including women and children. But one southern Israel resident says the bad press against Israel isn't fair.
Just remember, every time somebody holds up a child that has been hurt in Gaza, which we hope they aren't, but if they are, somebody needs to place beside that pictures from Syria. This has been a year and a half, 2 years going on, and nobody's getting in the middle of it. Nobody's yelling. I wish the yelling would stop at Israel. We are doing our best. We know our soldiers. They are not trying to do anything to the civilian population.
Israeli public support for the ongoing military operation remains high. In Jerusalem, hundreds of Israelis gathered at the Western Wall to pray for their nation and for protection for the army. They prayed Psalm 121, "He who keeps Israel neither slumbers nor sleeps." 31,000 reservists have already been called up for a possible ground offensive, but some Western leaders are warning Israel not to send Israeli soldiers into Gaza. Israeli Strategic Affairs Minister Moshe Ya'alon says Israel expects the world to stand behind Israel's right to defend itself.
We expect our allies to support us, to use all tools available in order to defend our people.
Julie Stahl, CBN News, Moshav Bertuvia, Israel.
Well, joining us now to talk more about Israel's battle with Hamas is Cliff May. Cliff is the president of the Foundation for the Defense of Democracies. Cliff, at the outset, let me ask you to help us understand why this is happening, because it seems foolhardy for Hamas to be doing this. What do they hope to gain from it?
It's a very good question and a very hard question to answer. I mean, at base, we know, or we should know, that Hamas is totally committed to the annihilation, the extermination of Israel. That's in the Hamas charter. Hamas will not negotiate. Hamas does not seek peace. Hamas does not seek a two-state solution. That's not a matter of interpretation. Hamas has said so many times, and again, it's right there in the charter. You can call it up and read it. Why they're doing this now is more mysterious, and why they're escalating, and they are escalating. They're using longer-range missiles, Fajr-5s and M-75s, that they have gotten from Iran. With help from Sudan, and possibly the Egyptians have knowingly allowed these missiles to be transported across their soil as well. Why are they doing that? Well, one reason may be because they don't have credibility as a militant terrorist organization fighting Israel's existence if they don't fight Israel from time to time. Secondly, they are a separate government from what's in the West Bank, where you have the Palestinian Authority and Mahmoud Abbas, who heads the Palestinian Authority, has said that at the end of this month he's going to go to the United Nations and ask for enhanced status, observer status, non-state status, but at a new level to pursue the war against Israel in a different way. And I think Hamas may want to distract attention from that effort.
I see. You heard the, I believe it was the Israeli defense minister saying that they expect the world to rally around and support Israel's right to defend itself. Do the Israelis have the world's support?
No, they do not. They have some support. They do have the support, I'm pleased to say, of the Obama administration. President Obama said very clearly from his visit in Asia that Israel is being attacked by hundreds of missiles, as you just showed. And any nation, not least Israel, including Israel, has a right to defend itself when it is under attack. What you see from a lot of nations is not that. Those nations that don't believe Israel has a right to exist don't believe that Israel has a right to defend itself. That follows, obviously. And then there are countries that pursue moral equivalence. Israel gets hit by rockets, Israel responds, both sides are to blame. That kind of moral equivalence is way, way too prominent and too prevalent in Europe and, frankly, in parts of the United States.
Cliff, we could talk much longer about this, but we'll stay in contact with you to get more insights. Thanks for being with us today. We appreciate it.
Thank you, Lee.
The president of Afghanistan says the U.S. is violating an agreement over the capture and holding of detainees. Hamid Karzai says more than 70 Afghans who've been cleared by the courts are still being held by American forces, despite a detainee transfer pact signed earlier this year. His comments come just days after the start of negotiations on a bilateral security agreement. That agreement will determine U.S. military presence in Afghanistan after troop withdrawal in 2014. Karzai's critics say this is just another example of the president using populist opinion to give him leverage in talks with Americans.
Some members of Congress want to know who helped create the Obama administration's talking points on the deadly attacks on the U.S. consulate in Libya. Hearings on Capitol Hill have revealed the CIA concluded early on that terrorists were to blame for the assault. Lawmakers now want to know who took that critical information out of the White House's early statements. The answer could explain why UN Ambassador Susan Rice kept describing the incident as a spontaneous protest that was sparked by an anti-Islam video. Democrats say the CIA signed off on the final talking points, but Republicans question whether the White House was trying to cover it up, fearing it would cause voters to question the president's claim that the U.S. had hurt al-Qaeda's power.
She would have sat out the National Security Council, and she would have known that those talking points had been watered down, and she could have caveated that in a statement, which she didn't. She left a clear impression that this was a spontaneous demonstration based on the video.
And I blame the president more than anybody else. Susan Rice is a bit player here. Was he informed of the June attack on our consulate where they blew a hole where 40 people could go through? Was he aware of the August 15th cable where Stevens was saying we can't withstand a coordinated al-Qaeda attack? They're 10 militia groups all over Benghazi. I blame the president, Senator, for making this a death trap.
Senator Dianne Feinstein, a Democrat, heads the Senate Intelligence Committee. She does not believe the White House altered the document for political reasons.
Top lawmakers say they're confident they can come together to prevent America from driving over the fiscal cliff. Both sides say there's a greater willingness to compromise now. Mark Martin has an update on ways to work against Taxmageddon.
Republican and Democrat leaders agree on an outline to reform the tax code and government benefit programs next year, but they first need to put the brakes on the country falling over the fiscal cliff at the end of this year. That's the $600 billion combination of across-the-board tax increases and spending cuts set to begin in January that could send a fragile economy back into recession.
The two sides have identified the tax revenue that we're willing to discuss, and now it's time to talk about the spending reductions. And that's the prescription for moving forward, because, again, if we pass something that doesn't solve the problem, then the American people are going to be as irritated in the future as they are right now.
So just to close loopholes is far too little money. It could be, they have said they want it to be revenue neutral. If it's going to bring in revenue, the president has been very clear that the higher income people have to pay their fair share.
Americans are skeptical. Business owners and investors are rapidly maneuvering to shield themselves from possible higher taxes next year. So many investors are shedding investments, which is contributing to recent sell-offs in formerly high-flying shares like Apple and Amazon. Louisiana Governor Bobby Jindal says it's crucial both sides do more than a temporary fix.
But here's the second point. When it comes to this fiscal cliff, I was in Congress. I guarantee you, if they just put a Band-Aid on this, we'll be at another fiscal cliff in a few months from now. We need structural changes, and that could be a balanced budget amendment to the Constitution, a supermajority vote before they raise our taxes.
New Hampshire Senator Kelly Ayotte, who responded to the president's weekly address, summed up the situation by saying power sharing is an opportunity, not an obstacle, and getting our fiscal house in order is where we need to start. Mark Martin, CBN News.
Some of the fiscal cliff solutions could decrease donations to charities. The Charitable Giving Coalition is sending letters, though, to President Obama and lawmakers urging them to protect the tax deduction for givers. The White House has proposed capping all itemized deductions at 28% for certain taxpayers, and a bipartisan debt reduction panel has proposed eliminating the deduction and replacing it with a tax credit. A study by the fundraising firm Dunham & Company shows most Americans favor the charitable tax deduction and would donate less if it was eliminated.
A federal court issued a temporary injunction against an Obamacare mandate for Bible publisher Tyndale House. The Illinois-based company objects to the provision that requires coverage for abortion-inducing and contraception drugs. The court initially questioned whether Tyndale House was religious enough for an exemption. Friday's ruling stops the enforcement of the mandate for Tyndale. It's the third ruling of its kind nationwide against the Obamacare provision.
Thanksgiving isn't even here yet, and the battles over Christian Christmas displays is already heating up. The city of Santa Monica, California, is dropping its elaborate nativity scene after an atheist protest. The city allowed a nativity in Palisades Park for nearly 60 years, including a series of 14 life-size Christmas displays. But then atheists set up non-religious displays. That angered the community by comparing the Christmas displays to myths and fables. The churches that used to set up the nativity scene have sued in federal court, citing freedom of speech violations. But today, a judge ruled against their request to force the city to reopen the display.
Coming up, why gun enthusiasts are stocking up after the president's reelection.
Your dryer runs forever, and your clothes still come out damp? Now you can speed up your dryer by up to 15 minutes. Introducing the Lint Lizard. It's like a magic wand that cleans deep into any dryer. The flexible Lint Lizard attaches right to any vacuum hose. Look how much lint we got out of this dryer. All this lint that escapes past your lint screen. Yuck. A clogged dryer works harder. All that lint can even burn out your motor. Or worse, it can start a dangerous vent fire. It's a full 40 inches long and cleans deep into your vent system, grabbing all the packed-in lint that's choking your dryer. After a quick cleaning with the Lint Lizard, your dryer vent is clear, making it work less and run more efficiently. Old-fashioned lint brushes pull out some lint, and the lint gets everywhere. The Lint Lizard cleans deeper and sends the lint right into your vac bag. Vacuuming between machines and under appliances is a snap. Take it outdoors to vac your outside vent. So before you spend a fortune on costly repairs, order your Lint Lizard for just $10.99. Call right now and you can double your order. And that's not all. We'll also include the Dust Lizard. It attaches to any vac and adjusts to any position. The Dust Lizard goes where no other attachment can. Clean delicate electronics, tedious air vents, tiny tile crevices, crumbs from corners, dirt from slider tracks, places you could never vacuum before, even expensive sculptures and intricate chandeliers. Plus, the Lint Lizard comes with a money-back guarantee. If you're not completely satisfied, return them and keep the Dust Lizard. You get it all, two Lint Lizards and the Dust Lizard for $10.99. Call now and find out about free shipping.
Call 1-800-373-2150 and get your Lint Lizard. But call now and you can get a special offer on a second Lint Lizard and the Dust Lizard with your order. So call 1-800-373-2150 and find out about free shipping. That's 1-800-373-2150. Call now.
Well, you may remember that during the presidential debates, President Obama said he would consider trying to get a ban on assault weapons reintroduced.
Now, gun sales are up in the wake of the president's reelection, driven by fears of tighter regulations. Dale Hurd has that story.
The nation's gun show at the Dulles Expo Center in Northern Virginia was packed. Guns and ammo were selling out. On this table, all that was left were a few T-shirts.
Many, many, many more people are here buying guns than before.
Annette Elliott runs the show with her family. She says customers are stocking up, and she thinks the biggest reason is President Obama and fear of a gun ban.
People are afraid now that President Obama is back in, and they know before he was president, he said a lot of very anti-gun things.
Although not everyone agrees.
This president has done next to nothing as far as like what you would call gun control laws.
This buyer was happy to go through a background check and wished other states took better precautions.
As far as these purchasing of just unlimited amounts of, you know, say really deadly assault rifles, and you can just turn around and sell them to anyone you want at any time, I mean, that's just asking for trouble.
Whatever the reason, Americans are building arsenals of knives, collectibles, hunting rifles, assault weapons, even machine guns.
I personally don't think there's more than a very small chance of large-scale civil unrest, but there's a very small chance that you'd have a fire in your kitchen, but most people still have a fire extinguisher.
Background checks were done right on site, and 175 attendees went through the training course required for a concealed carry permit in Virginia.
175 people this weekend alone.
Event organizers say they've also seen a large increase in the number of women buying guns.
You know, you'd think the main thing women would be afraid of is assault or robbery or something like that, but ever since 911, we've had an increase from 5% to 30%.
Dale Hurd, CBN News.
Up next, an aerial offensive reaching people in North Korea. The unique method being used to spread the gospel.
It's probably something I've had for many years, and every year the PSA would be a little higher. I just kept kind of ignoring it. You know, one of those guy things. It'll go away. It'll go away. Finally, one day, Janet says, "You're going to the doctor." They did a blood test. My PSA was 14. I needed to get a second opinion, so we contacted Cancer Treatment Centers of America.
To find out more about Cancer Treatment Centers of America and our unique treatment options for complex and advanced stage cancer, go to cancercenter.com.
The really great thing is that you just go online, and if you have prostate or lung cancer or whatever, you can see what their survival rates are.
You can also check for participating insurance plans. Cancer Treatment Centers of America is different. You feel it the moment you call or walk into one of our hospitals. It's state-of-the-art medicine, unique treatment options, and a level of compassion that cannot be copied. Why? Our people. People who give you not only their expertise, but their humanity, and the most thoughtful, well-organized, patient-centered care you'll find anywhere.
Cancer Treatment Centers of America go way beyond what normal hospitals do. I knew that they had the technology to take care of my cancer. It's a device called Calypso.
Calypso is GPS for the prostate. We're able to get four-dimensional, real-time tracking of prostate movement during radiation treatment.
It eliminates a lot of my side effects. It makes sense. It just makes sense. I own a deli. I'm back at work. My customers come in and say, "Gosh, you look good." And some of them say, "I look better now than I did before I left." I didn't expect to learn a lesson about how to treat people by being in a hospital. You can tell when somebody really cares.
Every minute counts when you're fighting complex or advanced stage cancer. So please call or visit cancercenter.com today. Appointments are available now. Cancer Treatment Centers of America, care that never quits.
President Obama is ending a tour of Southeast Asia today with an historical stop in Cambodia. Mr. Obama is the first American president to visit the country. The White House made it clear the president's visit is not an endorsement of Cambodia's prime minister, who's often criticized for his violent authoritarian rule. During what's being called a tense meeting with the prime minister today, President Obama voiced his concerns over human rights in the country. North Korea is also considered one of the world's worst offenders when it comes to human rights and religious freedom. For Christians, their faith could mean death.
Now one human rights group is taking action with an aerial offensive. George Thomas has tonight's focus report from South Korea.
Just before sunset, a vanload of Christians from Seoul heads north
We cannot show you their faces or reveal their names.
What we're doing could get us into trouble.
Where are we going today?
We're going here, some 4 miles from the North Korean border and close to the demilitarized zone.
The Demilitarized Zone, or DMZ, is one of the most heavily fortified and potentially dangerous places on Earth.
We'll just wait up here at the top of the stairs, sir.
1 million armed North Korean troops stand ready on their side of the DMZ. The South has just as many.
And as we get ready to head to this particular location, one factor that could ruin this whole thing is the weather.
One slight change in the wind direction could mess up the mission.
Peter has dubbed this Operation Dandelion.
We started this project back in 1991, and just as a dandelion needs the wind to spread its seed, we need the wind to spread the message.
That message is the Word of God, printed in the Korean language on thousands of bright orange balloons.
It's almost impossible to get Bibles into North Korea, so using balloons is one of the most effective ways to share the gospel.
A tank in the back of the van pumps helium into the balloons. The team works quickly, all the time keeping tabs on the wind direction. Prayers are whispered over each balloon. And then the release. A few minutes later, the balloons begin their slow drift across North Korean airspace.
By sending these balloons, we let our North Korean brothers and sisters know that we are praying for them, and the scriptures on the balloons are meant to encourage them.
The earnest prayers begin here at this undisclosed location in Seoul. Every week since 1991, 78-year-old Oh Mon-duk, along with a handful of other believers, has been preparing each balloon for the flight into North Korea.
I was born in North Korea. This is my way of helping to get the gospel back to my countrymen.
And the process is almost done. They're just putting the final touches to today's balloon operation. In essence, this is how it works. They have a hole in here that they fill helium in, put a tape around it, and then off it goes into the skies of North Korea.
The helium will leak out of the balloon and eventually fall to the ground. And when someone picks it up, they'll be able to read all 16 chapters of the Book of Mark.
Peter used boats in the past with other groups to launch balloon offensives from the sea. These balloons are larger and contain a small radio, a Bible, and other Christian literature. In addition to the balloon operation, Peter's group organizes a weekly radio broadcast that's recorded in Seoul, then transmitted over medium and shortwave frequencies into North Korea.
The radio broadcast is like a regular church service with worship and preaching of the word. The North Korean government routinely tries to jam our signal, but we have other methods of getting the message across.
And this is what motivates the team. CBN News obtained exclusive audio recordings and photographs of secret underground church meetings inside North Korea. And when a North Korean accepts Jesus Christ, he or she will face persecution, imprisonment, and possibly death because of their faith. Peter gave CBN News footage that apparently aired on a Japanese television channel, allegedly showing the execution of North Korean Christians. Trying to get precise figures on the number of Christians today in North Korea is extremely difficult.
Based on data gathered from North Korean defectors and international human rights groups, we estimate there are approximately 30,000 Christians being held in political prison camps, and about 10,000 underground believers who are in hiding throughout the country.
Back along a stretch of the North-South Korean border, it's a little past midnight. Using the cover of darkness, Peter's team continued to deploy hundreds of balloons at multiple locations. Today, the wind conditions have been good.
Often the winds will change suddenly and we have to wait. Sometimes we come back the next day. We are persistent. People's lives are on the line. We will continue to do this and continue to pray until North Korea is free and the Christians can worship Jesus Christ without fear.
Georgetown, CBN News, somewhere near the North Korean border.
Up next, missing money found and returned. One woman's story of doing the right thing.
My feet hurt, your feet hurt. White hot pain, I wanna cry. Is there anything I can try?
Why, yes. Introducing Strut Soul Angels, the human shock absorber that helps alleviate foot pain.
The first 10 steps in the morning to the bathroom were excruciating. Within 3 days after I put Struts on, it's been such a relief.
Slipped it on and almost immediately I felt a support, kind of like a pillow underneath my arches.
The Struts Soul Angel provides a great amount of relief and support throughout the course of the day, providing shock absorption and relief of pain.
On your feet without proper support can be painful. Struts Soul Angels promotes better balance, control, and body alignment. Standing in your heels all day is painful, but slip on Struts and you'll enjoy comfort and support 24/7. Struts is so versatile, you'll wear them in every shoe you own, even barefoot.
I'm on my feet all the time. I teach 11 and 12-year-olds. The pain was so much that I knew I had to do something. And with the Struts, I can do my job and enjoy my job.
I usually am on my feet from 8 to 12 hours a day. When I wear my Struts, it's like giving my feet a hug all day.
It's life-changing. I wear them from the minute I get up to the minute I go to bed.
Why pay $400 for custom orthotics?
Now get Strut Soul Angels for just $10. You also get Miracle Foot Repair Cream, absolutely free. Use it to help relieve dry, callous feet overnight. But wait, call right now and we'll double the offer free. Just pay separate processing and handling. Plus, you get a 100% money-back guarantee. If not completely delighted, send it back. But keep the foot cream as our gift just for trying. You get it all, a $70 value for just $10.
Oh, yes! Love my Struts, the best thing since sliced bread. They heal pain from toes to head. Get yours now, your doctor said.
Struts, be nice to your feet. Call now.
Call 1-800-787-1580 and get your Struts and Miracle Foot Repair for just $10 and we'll double the offer. That's 1-800-787-1580 or visit GetStruts.com.
And finally, it was a discovery that could have helped one Massachusetts woman with holiday shopping.
But in the end, Cheryl Gavazzi did the right thing.
I saw a roll of money.
Yep, Cheryl was shopping at her local Marshall store when she came across an attractive purse. Inside, she discovered more than she bargained for, over $11,000 more.
It was all $100 bills.
She came into the station, turned in the bag.
I'm glad he can have a happy family with his kids. He was going to have to sell his car.
Gives you faith in people that they're honest and trustworthy.
Yeah, it turns out the money had been reported missing. It belonged to a man who collected it in church. The money will go to build a church in Guatemala.
Wow.
Great story. Isn't
Praise
it?
The Lord. I know, especially this time of year. You love to hear that because it would have been tempting, and she did the right thing.
She got blessed as a result, I'm sure.
Amen. Well, that's going to do it for this edition of NewsWatch.
Remember, you can email us your comments and questions at newswatch@cbn.com. We hope you'll join us next time.
Good night.